gathered there was a sudden switch and change due to an issue of presenting the data in the other presentation. So what we've got today is a compilation based on what we presented at European Symposium on Classification and Comminution in September last year. And I ended up presenting all four papers because of funding issues. And so I was running back and forth. And I wove it into the story, the five presentations. And I kept saying to myself and to the group, we should make this one presentation. So this is unfortunately not the properly combined due to doing it at the last minute. It has the content, but it's not woven nicely into the story. I'll give some introduction around the story, which is we've had a set of comminution tests developed at the JK and other tests around the world that we've used, and based on the best guess or best estimate or an intuitive relationship between a testing mechanism and the comminution devices. And one of the biggest introductions from the JK was the drop weight test with the T10 curve. Bill here knows more about that than anyone else. So that was a way of relating the energy input to the fragmentation size, which is what all our comminution devices have been about. We can relate the energy to product size, we can predict their performance, and then incorporate that in the model. What we've been looking at here is as we develop more insight into the devices, we've realized that it's kind of been known in the background for a long time, but we've got more definition on the different mechanisms or modes or types of breakage. We actually try to define which terms we should use, which is in Fatima's PhD. So that's driven us to move our breakage testing to emulate the modes that are occurring in the devices. And this is what we present today, is a fair bit of the story behind that of trying to separate those out and then move into potentially the nuances of those equipment specific. If we know what the modes are, we know what, say from DBM modeling, what the modes are occurring in the machine, we can put that in our models that can allow the ratios of the different modes to change, the energies and the ratios of different modes. At the moment, we don't have that at all. So we suck it up in things like breakage rates and effect of geometry or equipment size is sucked up in fitting those rates. We can't actually predict them. So what we're hoping here is to get something that's more predictive that will respond to geometry, changes of energy, change of ratio of impact to surface damage. We don't have that in our models. And we'd really like to put that in. If we get really sophisticated, we'll start doing what we've used to, which is get geometry in. We're starting to have the tools to understand it and not how to put them in our model. So we're going to present the comminution testing here. The big step, which isn't going to be presented today, is how do you put those in models? We'll have to wait for the next exciting installment in about a year's time. We are starting to put them in models, but a test is quite useless on its own if you can't utilize the information. So that question might be in your mind when we're presenting, and it's a good question to have in your mind, how do we put these into the models as we move forward? In sort of a structured manner, we're going to start with Mohsen, and then we're going to go to Ben and then to me. I'm principally going to be presenting Fatima's work. So this is the work of multiple people, multiple students, and it's about an 8-year progression to here, and it still has gaps in it. But it's a story that's quite different to the historic evolution within the JK commission. So, over to Mohsen.
Good morning. So as Malcolm mentioned, my research team in ore characterization are trying to understand mainly the surface breakage. This is where I'm much more interested to understand how the surface breakage happens. And the idea in the whole research that I do is trying to isolate each of those individual mechanisms that happens in comminution environment and try to investigate each of those mechanisms in isolation to understand more what's happening, how the rock will respond to each of these modes of or mechanism of breakage. So this first slide looks at different standard test methods for characterizing ore, which is presented for different equipment and processes in comminution. And the interesting part is if you look at the SAG and AG, so at least there are 9 standard tests, and there are many non-standard tests in research centers that everybody uses for characterization. And it's interesting if you compare it to the other equipment. So that shows that the process that happens in SAG and AG is very complex. That's why we have so many tests. And that's why I started thinking that why we don't look at each of those processes to understand what's happening. So if you look at in a SAG or AG, so there are different breakage mechanisms active in different zones of the breakage in mean. So I separated them based on long discussion we had with Marcelo as well into body breakage and surface breakage. And and those mechanisms that cause body breakage, we can put as compression, which is between rock and rock, between two walls or wall and liners. And then high energy impacts, especially in this zone, we have high energy impacts. And attrition, then you have those small particles stuck between two large particles or two balls or a ball and a surface. So we're trying to identify all of these, or redefine all of these definitions as well, because there are lots of confusion in terms of application of these tests. Sometimes people will use attrition as what we named here as aggregation, and there are confusion between these type of terms. So in surface breakage, at the moment, the definition that we use is, we use the definition that was done by King and Tavares. With any mass loss of the particles less than 10% of the original mass, we assume as surface breakage at this stage. So it's an arbitrary number for now. But we use that as a measure for now, and then we're trying to build understanding and understand that it's the right number or it's a continuum between these two, surface and body breakage. And the mechanism that happens on the surface breakage, we have the low energy impact, which when you have two particles hitting each other with low energy, and also this is what we call shear abrasion, then when you shear a particle against the surface or against another particle. And what we want to do in our research, we try to isolate these mechanisms and try to understand them individually. And I'm specifically looking at surface breakage at different tests. So in this presentation, I'm going to present those tests that I'm using for studying surface breakage. Because of the short of time, I'll more explain the testing methodology. So I'll show a little bit of results, but hopefully in the near future, we can have more presentation results. Why we do this? So the idea is, if you understand each of these mechanisms, we can feed into more mechanistic models like UCM, which has individual mechanisms in mechanism of breakage for predicting the combustion device performance. And I'm more looking into abrasion and surface breakage, which is one of the components. First thing that, as part of what Carl, my MPhil student, has done, was looking into this question that can we use low energy impact as a proxy for abrasion? Is it possible to use that? Or can we consider both of them as the same mechanism? So for that, what we have done, we used the steel wheel abrasion test for looking at shear abrasion and compared with JKRBT with low energy impact to see how the product size and the mass loss are comparable in these two tests. So to be able to investigate whether we can use low energy impact as a proxy for abrasion or not. The steel wheel abrasion test, originally it was used by Peter Radishevsky and I think Tapio, I'm not sure if he's here or not, for checking the media width. And we had equipment here in JKTech, so we borrowed that equipment and we modified that to test the shear abrasion of rock particles. So the equipment has a rotating wheel, which we use it for abrading. And then they have a sample holder here, which originally they used it for holding the media, grinding media, and then they had an abrasive material on top, which basically they fit it in between. And when the rotating wheel rotates, so the abrasive material abrade debris from grinding media, and then they can measure the wear of the grinding media. So what we have done, instead of the grinding media, we use the rock particle, and then instead of abrasive material, we use just water for washing the debris that they come off the particle. So the equipment has, so you can apply a normal force here by adjusting the weight here, and then you have a torque arm here that you can apply the normal compression force, and using this load cell, you can measure how much normal force you apply. And the motor has a load cell which measures the torque for rotating the wheel as well. So you can measure the energy input to the abrasion, and also at the same time, you have the compression force. So we use this modified device for investigating individual particle abrasion. So the test procedure that we use, we call it INLAT, incremental mass loss test. So what we do, we have original particles, so we wash them and we have the original mass, and then with the known compression force and energy input, we abrade the particle. And then we have the particle after abrasion test, so we can measure the mass, we know the energy as well. So we can draw the mass loss of the particle per energy input, and then at different compression forces, because we can change the compression force. At the same time, at the defined time intervals, we collect the product of what abraded from the particle, so we can measure the size distribution of the progeny over time instead. Another test that we use for surface breakage, we call it abrasion test, which is, we did it in abrasion mill, or most people know it as Malcolm mill. So the idea here is, instead of having individual particles, we try to investigate the surface breakage of particles inside the mill. So when you look at the literature, most of the tests that they name as abrasion experiments, actually they test combination of different breakage mechanisms inside the mill, because they run the mill normally at 75% critical speed, and they have a wide range of size distribution. And in that condition, I did a DM simulation of that such condition. So you see that you have a high energy impact zone, which, because you have the wide range of size distribution, you might end up having surface breakage here because of the attrition and impact as well. And also here you have the attrition, and also you get the surface breakage. So we modified we use Markov mill at a very low speed, 40% of critical speed, and normally in each test we use a narrow size distribution as well. So in that sense, what we do, we remove these two body breakage from the test, and we mainly have the surface breakage. So we try to promote the surface breakage with this test. And then the other change is, we remove all the progeny of abrasion as big as possible. So for that, we use a water spray. So when the test is running, we have water spray inside the mill, and the mill has these product ports all around the circumference of the mill as well. So while the mill is running, we have a wash water, so we collect all the progeny of the abrasion from these outlets. And this is how we just remove those products over time. So in that way, we have the product of the size distribution of the product of surface breakage over time, and also we can look at the masses of the particles. So the procedure is, you put the angular rock inside the mill, and you run the mill, and every half a minute we collect the product. So during the first half, it will be product one, second half product two, and we continue up to 10 to 15 minutes, depending on the hardness of rock. Then you stop the mill, you measure the mill content, you have the size distribution of the mill content. So those rubber particles are already are smooth, so we put them back and we do another round of the test with the smoothed particles. So we have the product size distribution over the time, And also we know the size distribution initially and after 10 or 15 minutes, what's the meat content. And so we tested different ore, but in this presentation we presented the Acadia ore, Tefra ore, and Acadia East ore, which they have a range of hardness. Acadia ore is basically it's known as moderately hard, Tefra is moderately soft, and Acadia East is hard ore. And at the same time, to be able to track individual particle surface breakage as well, we use tracer rocks. So normally in each test, from each size fraction, we use 7 to 10 individual particles. So we number each of those particles and we paint them different color because we know each color is representing one size fraction. And we have the initial mass. So we put them inside the meat. When we run the surface breakage test, after test, we recover those particles. And then you measure the mass of those particles. So you know how much they lost mass during the surface breakage, due to the surface breakage. So these are a few tests that I was looking at using them for understanding the surface breakage. And we define a term, fractional mass loss, which is the difference between initial and after surface breakage mass loss, the fraction of the mass loss divided by the initial mass per surface specific energy. So the energy that you give to the surface area of the particle, because we believe that the surface breakage is a process that has to do with the surface of the rock. So the energy, instead of having it as kilowatt per ton, now we define it as kilowatt hour per meter squared, which is the surface area of the particles. And with the help from NEMA as well, so for understanding more, we use DM simulation as well to understand how the energy distribution occurs inside the meat when you change the condition. So for every test that we have done, we did the DM simulation as well. So for the angular particles, we use the six different shapes as shapes of the lumped particles to present the angularity of the particles. And when we did the test with the smooth particles, normally we use spheres as to present the smooth particles. And then we look at the normal and tangential energy of collisions happening inside the meat to understand what's happening inside the meat when we change the condition. And trying to link it back with experimental data. So some of the outcomes, first thing that we tested was we wanted to understand whether we can use impact, low energy impact as a proxy for abrasion. Here I brought the coarsest product that we got from shear abrasion from SWAT device, which is blue line, and the finest product we get from low energy impact. And also, we did one test with very high energy, 2 kilowatt per ton as well, to see whether we get a finer size distribution. And I present it here. And you see that they are not comparable. So definitely in terms of size distribution, low energy impact does not produce the same size distribution as abrasion. And abrasion is much finer. So we had much finer than this product as well during the abrasion test, depending on applied compression force, but we said that okay, we just use the coarsest one that we had and finest from JKLBT to see if they are comparable, but they haven't been there. So, and if you look at the mass loss, it's the same thing. The only issue is the base for comparing the energy, because in abrasion we define the energy as kilowatt hour per surface area or kilojoule per surface area. But in JKRBT, we define that as kilowatt per ton, the mass of the particle. And the problem we had was how to define the surface area that energy applied in impact. Still, that's something that we are trying to work with both new models there to see if we can convert the energy here to the same base as abrasion to be able to compare the energy and mass loss. And using the abrasion test, we are hoping to move forward to develop an abrasion index for rocks as well. So here I presented two ore, BODZ ore and Acadia, the response that we get from abrasion test. So the x-axis shows the mass loss per kilojoule energy input to the particle, and the y-axis. The x-axis shows the normal force applied to the particle when we did the ablation test. And you see a linear behavior from rod, and that tells you that the applied force has a significant effect in terms of mass loss that you get from ablation. But the response of rod depends on its hardness, or not the hardness, actually, it's ablation behavior. And we think that we might be able to use the slope of this line as kind of like an ablation index for particles. So we are working on to get more rod with different property to see do we get still the same linear behavior or not, and then we can try to understand more and develop an ablation index. Next thing was from the ablation wheel that we did some tests. Actually, it's not ablation, it's a surface breakage test. So I'm looking at response of different ore type in these two graphs, which this one is when the particles are angular, and then this one when the particles are smooth. And we're looking at the response of the surface breakage of those rocks at different size fraction. And as you can see here, so definitely they rank based on their hardness. So as ore gets softer, the amount of surface breakage that you get is higher. But the response to the size becomes more evident when the ore is softer. So when we deal with the hard rock, we didn't get too much difference in terms of the surface breakage for different size ranges. So one of the things that we saw was there was a difference in response of the rock to the surface breakage based on size when it's angular and when it becomes smooth. So when it's smoother, so you don't see much difference between different size of the particles in terms of their response to surface breakage. When they are angular, the smaller particles, they suffer more from surface breakage than coarser particles. And we had a look into energy distribution when we did the DM simulations as well. So these two graphs, they show the normal specific energy per contact, per surface area of the particle. And this one shows the tangential energy for the angular and smooth one. And you see that, so the angular one, the tangential force for the angular particles is more significant compared to the smooth one. While when you look at the normal, so it's not a big difference, but this time smooth particles they sense more normal forces, and we're trying to link this to the response that we get here in breakage of a surface breakage of angular and smooth one. So the results is not conclusive yet. We need to do more experiments to understand the relationship, and we are working on that one. But the idea is, We can use DM simulation and those detailed understanding from DM simulation to link it back to experimental results. So to conclude, we developed some new methods for investigating surface breakage in isolation to characterize the response of rock for single particles. And also we have a methodology to link DM outcomes with experimental results for more understanding and bringing out those effective mechanisms. And the next step would be linking those single particle surface breakage into grinding, actually, and putting it into the model, which is an ongoing research. Okay. Thank you very much.
Hey. Okay. Any questions?
Let's see the next one. Okay.
Good morning, everyone. So my name is Ben Malcolm, and I'm going to present today a little study about strain rate effects. So this is a paper that was presented by Malcolm at the ESCC conference in Sweden. So I didn't go there, but Malcolm presented that paper. So I never presented that. I hope I'm going to manage to do it. in a short time. So basically, what is strain rate and why are we looking at it? So this is kind of a visualization of what I wanted to do is when you do a breakage test, what is the effect of the loading rate? The loading rate is how much rate you apply, stress you apply within a certain time. So basically, you can drop in the top weight test, you can drop a heavy weight from a low drop height or a light weight from a high drop height. So what is the impact on the tests? What is the impact on the product size distribution? Before anyone jumps, it was done in the literature before. It's shown here. For the different tests like impact load cell or impact tests with a free fall, this was studied in the past. But what we wanted to do is to extend that range to a larger range of strain rate and going to much higher velocities. For example, when you drop a weight in the drop weight tester, the free fall speed is about 1 to 2 meters per second. Okay? And in this study, we went up to about 100 meters per second in terms of impact velocity. So we went straight outside this range. Just to avoid redoing what was done in the literature and to investigate what is the relationship with the existing device. So what Malcolm said at the beginning is, how can we then include that in our models to adapt the test outcomes to actually what's going on in the device? If there is high impact velocities in the device, like a vertical impact pressure, vertical shaft impact pressure, where the speeds are how much higher. So basically, this is the framework of the test. And to do this, we used a pneumatic impact device. So this device was actually, I'm glad we have Rajiv here, he knows a lot about this. He actually recommissioned this device. It was in the mechanical engineering department, sitting under a pile of dust, and they didn't want to do any test with it. So we actually took it back here at the JK, recommissioned it, and then we said, okay, what test can we do with that device to get some meaningful outcomes? So this is why we designed this test. So this device is a pneumatic device, so it's got a gas cylinder here and a little projectile, like a bullet, a steel bullet. So basically you pressurize the cylinder here and you can shoot the bullet to a target. Target being like usually a rock sitting against an anvil. So this allows to get to much higher impact velocities compared to what is usually done in the top plate test. So the first step was to design the impact speed that was possible in this device. And to do that, we just changed the pressure and measured the velocity of impact with high-speed videos. So this here, you're looking at an overview of the impact. So it's looking from above. The particle being crushed is here. That's a rock cube. It's a basalt cube. The impact size is still bullet, and the bullet is traveling to the, so it's horizontal, okay? What you see vertically here. And this is what happened when we changed the pressure. So we gradually increased the pressure in the gas cylinder, measured the speed of impact. So you can see that, of course, the product has different fineness because here we have different energies. So then what we did is we calibrated the device, and we found, of course, a linear relationship between the gas pressure in the cylinder and the impact energy, okay? Which is expected because the energy contained in the gas is related to the energy of the impactor, okay? So then I said, well, what can we do with this device to get an understanding of the strain rate? And to do that, I choose to do a constant energy, and that's quite important because it needs to be a consistent energy across all strain rates. So it's how do you apply 1 kilowatt hour per ton to the same rock but with different impact speed? Okay. And to do that, we use both the drop weight test and the pneumatic device. So this is an example of the change of the relationship between the mass of impact and the speed of impact for the same energy. So in the top weight test, if you use a 25 kilograms head, the free fall speed is 3.2 meters per second, and that gives 1 kilowatt hour per time. And if you change the mass of the head to 15 kilograms, then the striker speed goes up to 4 meters per second and still 1 kilowatt hour per time. And then we went into the pneumatic device, where the steel bullet, so it's the just a small cylinder, weighs only 380 grams. And then you have to have an impact speed of 25 meters per second to get still 1 kilowatt hour per time. So that's all the tests are done with 1 kilowatt hour per time. So the maximum speed, so it's a tiny little bullet traveling at 51 meters per second. Okay. So we drilled little rock cylinders, I've got one here. So that was just to avoid any variation due to the shape effect. So we just drilled those basalt cylinders and we break them. So that was to avoid any viability to a irregular shaped particle. So that's what we use in the test. So then we did the test for the five tests here, and then we're going to look at the product size distribution. But first, a little bit more on the testing methodology. So this is this particle being crushed in the top weight test. You can see the head falling on the particle and being crushed. Of course, what's happening is that after the first fracture, the breakage, the fragments are being captured again, and they are being broken again. So that was not ideal because that was not happening in the gas can device. So we had to modify the dot weight test. And what we did is we just put like a little steel cylinder, the same shape as in the pneumatic device. And we dropped the head on this cylinder. So you can see the head moving down, and then it's going to catch the impactor and then it's going to break the particle. So what it does is that then it stops the head from falling down on the fragments. So you just get the breakage of the cylinder on the sample. Okay. And then we actually did the test, and that's just an example of on the left side the top weight and on the right side the pneumatic device, the same sample and the same energy. Okay. Well, of course, you can observe that the product fineness is different, and it's still the same energy. Okay. But just the way we derived the results, so we did the video, all the video analysis of high-speed videos of the impact to get the precise speed of the impactor here on the pneumatic device, or the speed of the head, of the top weight head. That was just to be sure of the exact speed of impact. Okay. And then we looked at the product size distribution. So on the left side, that's the product obtained breaking that at 1 kilowatt hour per ton, and on the right side is the top weight test. Okay, so we can already see quite an important difference. The main difference is that you can see on the side here the two large fragments being broken a little bit like a Brazilian test that escaped the dog weight test. In the case of the pneumatic device, we found that those fragments were rebroken here. So this one is equivalent to this one. And that's probably due to secondary breakage. Okay, in the impact device, the speed of the motion of the fragments after impact, they're going to move and they're going to impact the chamber, the target chamber, and they're going to impact the wall and break again. So this is why here we have the difference of the large.
Then,
yes.
I think you have proven the mind to mill concept here. You've proven the mind to mill concept here. What you're saying is, for the same energy at a higher load of rating, you get a lot more fines.
Yeah, you can see the sizing results.
That's what you have proven there.
So we sized the particles, and you can see here the product size distribution. So the first red line and the blue line is in the dot weight test. So we can already see a difference in the fineness. And then we increase the speed and increase it even more the product fineness to 26, 39, and 52 meters per second. That's still all the same 1 kilowatt hour per second. Okay. What we also noticed is that the rate of change, or the increase in fineness, was not really higher for the higher when increasing the speed. But that's maybe, that needs maybe more testing. What's happening is in the pneumatic device, just to break one rock, it's about 2 hours to set up the gas, pressurize the cylinder, impact the rock, collect the particles. So it's not like a drop weight test where you can do 30 particles quite quickly. If you need 30 particles, you need 60 hours on the device. So yeah, that definitely needs more. But yeah, increase of fineness. As I was saying before, when we look at the top size here, it's the large fragments on the side that survived. In the case of the pneumatic device, they were broken, so we don't see them here. So that's what you're seeing in this case. But the other interesting fact is that we looked at the slope of the size distribution, and we find it constant. So it means that there is a, and then, okay, so it brings the fact that the material properties define the fineness for the same energy, okay, or the shape of how the rock is going to break. The shape of that size distribution is contained in the texture of this rock. But then, with the different strain rate, you change the actual amount of where this size distribution is going to sit. Okay? And that relates as well to the fractal dimension of this size distribution. Conclusion is in perspective. So we find that at consistent speed, at consistent energy, but at different strain rate, we have an increase in fineness. We extended the range of what was done in the literature to much higher speed. We have seen that there's a pattern in the size distribution, same fractal dimension for all the products. And what we have initiated beyond is not here today, so beyond Medley is now currently looking at validating those tests in DEM. And looking at what happens when you simulate that test. And it's quite easy to do because we choose the regular shape. So what you see here is the sample, the DEM, micro DEM model here, that's the impactor, fracturing the sample, and you can see the same pattern of the large fragments are going to move on the side and find in the field. So that's currently ongoing work. Okay, outstanding work. Well, we'd like to do another rock type in order to validate what I was saying about the texture and the influence of texture on the fractal dimension of the product size distribution. And there is another challenge that is looking at us, is how do we avoid re-breakage? So you've seen that in the pneumatic device, the fragments move and are broken again. And there is a opportunities to capture those materials before the impact. So something like a ballistic jelly where the energy would be dumped or waxed around the sample where it would be dumping the energy to avoid any re-breakage. Okay, we haven't done that, but that's definitely an opportunity. Yeah, a padded chamber or something to capture. The other challenge is to stop the motion of the striker. You've seen that the striker keeps moving until it actually hits the anvil, where all the material is being crushed. The other thing we could look at is stop the impactor before it breaks, before it hits the anvil. And that's quite challenging when you have a steel bullet traveling at 50 meters per second. How do you stop that from hitting the anvil? Don't know yet. It's possible in the drop weight test, was done before, but in the pneumatic device, it's challenging. And just a link with Fatima's work, PhD, that's going to be presented by, so extending the range of high speed of strain rates. And I think Malcolm is going to present that. Thank you.
Can I ask a quick question, Ben, there? Have you still got the progenies?
Yes.
Have you done any tomographic on those progenies?
No.
Maybe have a look at that one, whether with the high strain rates, the general theory would be as the strain rate keeps increasing, the fractures do not have enough time to propagate, so they can actually diversify the earth and get a lot of microfractures. Maybe have a look at the progeny. absorb any of those microfracturing phenomena.
Are you willing to quit all the
That's probably a good for us to see, no, but that's the next step to look at. High strain rates. One thing you've proven is it produces more fines, that's what we see in the minefield. The blasting produces more fines.
And the other thing is testing another ore type, so like a real ore, that's copper ore.
Yeah.
And then looking at the inference of texture on that.
I think you also need to test the real shape of rock instead of getting regular shape, cylinder shape. Because I think that the effect of applied strain rate would show itself when you're using this regular shape and those big pieces.
Yeah.
But if you use that real rock shape, I think you won't see that much difference.
Yeah, that's correct. But then the issue is you need to have a high number of particles.
Yes.
As I said, I repeated that test 10 times, so 20 hours on the device. If you want to do random shape particles, you need more particles.
Of course.
But yes, it's possible, but time constraints really that test.
The procedure itself, yes.
Sounds like a 4 or 5x students required to work that machine, so that's
yeah, I wouldn't let the breakage system in there.
And also caution the mining man to let the work complete before he draws conclusions. So the pots of families, which is a nice segue from what Ian presented, it overlaps and presents a different aspect to where we've got to so far, and also overlaps with the original work Rajiv did. So we, if we look at the motivation behind the work, so we've got a characterization of parameters and predictive model. The current practice is a testing device which we relate to rock response. And it seems to be overlooked both in the literature and the discussions I hear, that I've done a test and that's the strength of the rock. That's not. The test is giving a response of the rock to the test. It's not the strength of the rock. And it's a common misperception. It's a convenience, of course, which maybe the original people realize it's just a convenience. Call it the strength. It's not the strength. And therefore, when we run different tests, we can get different strengths. They are not different strengths, okay? They're the same rock giving different responses to different testing conditions. And that's what Fatima is digging into. It's what we've been digging into for some time, and we are gaining clarity on that. So if you look at a rock by test, you've got a flat geometry, you run two different ores, you get the classic TTM response, and you can therefore relate that to the response in the mill. So this is a nice, coherent, consistent manner of characterizing the response of an ore to a specific testing methodology. Okay. So that's a specific style of test, and it gives you a really consistent output, which is a key part of doing any characterization. It's going to be a mass characterization, and it's the key to the success of the rock by test. It's really consistent testing technique, and you can use the outputs in the model. Oops, I'm going 2, 3, 4, okay. I had a touch screen when I was in Cape Town. When I put my finger near it, 5 slides went by. I touched the other side and they went back and forth. So I'll stick to the buttons on there. I'm not sure if this is a touch screen. So what about the effect of geometry? And we do, right here, we do a drop rate test and then we do a short impact load cell with the ball. And it's always worried me, what's the difference between having the ball and the flat plate hitting the rock? And I've been asking questions for a while, and so I've done a lot of work around that. I said, of course I've done that already. So if you want to know about breakage, he's always a good guy to speak to, because normally you just need to read one of his previous papers. Which is why he's a co-advisor for Fatima, because we couldn't leave him out the room on that. So what is, when we look at drop weight test versus what might happen in the mill and the different surfaces, does it matter that we're doing a flat versus what's the real geometry of interaction in the mill? So this is Tavares, as I mentioned, 97, so it's a while back. And he did tests with ball on flat, ball on ball, and flat on flat. We can see here, you get a slightly different product size distribution with the flat on flat versus the others. And that's at a low energy of 0.24 kilowatts per ton. Then he did 1.8, which was lower than our testing regime. Obviously, the whole distribution is fine. But the point here is that the distribution by geometry is dramatically different. So the influence of geometry is marked when you go up to a higher energy. And quite distinct that the red, flat and flat, eliminates the coarse end. Goes straight to what was seen in Ben's one, where at the flat on flat it caught the coarse particles. So he made it the little cylinder to be equivalent, which didn't catch the coarse particles, and you could see them sitting outside. This is the full flat, so it catches the coarse particles. There's clearly an effect of geometry, which is to do with that recapture that Ben already showed. So we're seeing it that the testing device is a comminution process. It's not a strength test. This is the strength of the particle. It's a comminution process, is what the story is coming out to be. So they undergo different processes, and there's definitely an interaction between the energy and the geometry. So the energy has an effect. Is it the energy or is it something else? Of course, if you have more energy, the striker keeps moving for longer, so the influence of the geometry is greater. Quite straightforward, actually. If you just break it, who cares what the geometry is? You can put a whole lot of energy in, it does matter. That's really clear in this work, and it's helped set the path that we go on. So this is the work with Kladimer, that's with a silk. So we've got an impact there, and then that's a compression with a really precise instrument across on the main campus in UQ. And it's done quite different applied strain rates. You've got energy inputs varying 0.06 to 1.6, 0.03 to 0.5, so they overlap. But the applied strain rate goes up to 2 meters per second, and this is 10 to the minus 6 in compression times. So many orders of magnitude slower. And how would they compare with those? What we did do, and I've emphasized on the next slide, we did also account for geometry. So Fadler did this with a rod dropping on a rod, a ball on a rod, that disc on there, and also a curved surface to emulate the ball, so we could take away the geometry effect. So these were with ball on flat. If I'm not mistaken, this particular set of data was a ball on flat. So in the instron, it was a half a ball being squashed in. And impact and compression for magnetite silicate identical. So this here is specific fraction energy and cumulative fraction energy distribution. So the 50% you can relate to the true rock strength potentially. So that's the distribution of strength of a whole lot of separate samples. So Federer's done lots of hard work here. That's a whole lot of individual samples and the cumulative distribution. So that's a natural strength distribution of the rock. And that's part of our story, is instead of using averages, using a distribution. When you look at the size distribution out of those tests, the silicon magnetite, it doesn't matter whether you did it under the really slow compression or the higher velocity of a drop weight test, which was the silk. The size distribution is the same. So actually the pure rate didn't matter there, which was an interesting output. Bear in mind the story that Ben's spoke. So we don't know yet, is this just in this applied strain rate, is not an effect when you go higher there is, or has Ben observing a geometry effect? We haven't pulled that apart to answer the mining engineer. You haven't pulled that apart yet. Okay?
What's the difference in your strain rates? I think that is probably.
Yeah, so these are both relatively low.
Yeah, that's
okay.
The difference.
That's why I'm making the point. Is there a point where you get to a much higher strain rate where it does matter? And is it the strain rate, or is it that you recapture the pot?
So when we recapture the breakage, this one is not going to be breakage as well.
It's just the primary fragmentation.
Yeah. So what we see in the others is if you keep recapturing the particles instead of them escaping, you have more effective use of energy, and that's most probably the real secret, is that instead of the energy being dissipated, you actually keep using it. It gets captured again and again and again. You keep using that energy that could be dissipated. And that most probably is the trick, which keeps the mining guy happy. You can contain that energy, you use it more effectively. You keep using it again and again.
I think the problem, Malcolm, you know, fracture mechanics theory has explained all these things a long, long time back. It's basically what your first statement when you said it, when you define the breakage, we need to understand how we are actually applying the load. Okay, how are we applying the stresses and how the rock is breaking? Okay? When you apply the strain rate, as you're talking about, how those fractures within particles are propagating. And there are certain rules for each of those things. How they, the fracture mechanics theory, if you go that one, that explains it.
There's another effect there where when you below the natural, the stress wave propagation, it just doesn't matter. When you exceed it, it really does matter. So blasting, you can exceed it. We don't have Dion here, but also jump into that one. But let's not get sidetracked too much now.
Okay.
I was just showing you the photograph of these quite different magnetite and silica being impacted. You can see the silica spreading out, the brittle rock and the magnetite in it. And when you look at it on the top, we see the magnetite after a breakage event. It's quite well contained and the silica is really spread out. We see two effects here, magnetite being softer, but that must be related to how it's responded in the test, not just the material property. Plus we see a slight difference in the, say, within the silica or within the magnetite of when we've gone compression or impact. And is that to do with the capturing of the particles, or is it to do with that there's a real change? It seems that's to do with the capturing of the particles. So you've got two effects happening here, not just one, not just rock strength. So it relates to hardness and effects of spatial difference. What if we control the environment? So you have a single breakage event, you get first fragmentation, then you can get secondary. We know this happens in the dot weight test, and it's quite well illustrated with Ben's work as well. So if we consider it as a sequence of first fractioning, you get classification, you have a selection function, you have re-breakage, goes back. So it loops through in a whole lot of steps, basically equivalent steps where the bed is changing. Number of particles start with 1, then it's 5, and then it's 20, and then it's 50. And they're spreading out onto a loose bed. Now, this is not a confined bed breakage. And we've seen that effect. So this is the model that's envisaged by Fatima and with a lot of input from Marcella, when she spent a couple of months at the University of Rio. They developed this model. So the concept is that you describe this as those stages, and it now has a model running mathematically that keeps going through these stages where you break, classify, select, does it stay in or remove? So classification after the first breakage is removed from the breakage zone, or it won't get broken anymore. If it's in the breakage zone, then is it selected for re-breakage or not? And if it is, it gets rebroken. If it isn't, it stays in the breakage zone still. And then you have another classification step. So you do sequences of these steps. And each of them considered only as a primary breakage event, not a final breakage event, only based on primary breakage. How do you get primary breakage? You break the rocket. Just sufficient energy to break. So we've now got your primary breakage log, so your primary breakage distribution. And then you run that, only that, to break the entire sequence of a full breakage event. You've only measured the primary breakage, which you've broken it just enough for initial fragmentation. You've got the energy and the product size. Then your classification is rock dependent. Is it a soft or a brittle rock? And what's the geology? Both of those affect the classification. Whether it will leave the zone or stay in the zone. And then the selection. Once, after the first step is selection is one, the rock gets selected. The next one, of which fragments of which size get selected. These are three dramatically different ones to do a sensitivity analysis. We don't know what the selection function should be. Where The green line is the big ones get selected, which seems intuitive. The blue line is the big and the smaller have a probability. And the red line is the fines that are actually trapped in this loose bed have a high probability of being broken. So we're just taking it through an extreme. Not saying which one is correct, just testing it through an extreme. When we change this, so Fatima has done those three that I've shown you, and apply to the same initial primary fragmentation and the same energy, you get different sizes of fusion, markedly different sizes of fusion. The consequence is, again, same material, same hardness, same initial fracture, primary fracture distribution, completely different AIB. Just change the selection function. And that could be equivalent to changing geometry of the impactor, or the impact, or the effect of the brittleness or softness of the material. Both of those would affect that. And so you get completely different data out of this. But this is the extreme, of course. That has changed them a lot, but it shows it is an important factor. So, what do we get? We can describe it. We haven't presented Fatima's latest data. I'm not going to presume to do that because it's her data. She'll present that in the future. But you can describe it by regarding a what we call a breakage test, actually as a comminution process with multiple stages. And we're having quite good success in that, me being Fatima doing all the work and us looking at it. So you've got primary classification, fragmentation, selection, classification. What does this mean? I can take a rock and apply just enough energy to fracture it, test done. I can then predict what happens in any different comminution box if I get this right. It also means as I change the environment to my real comminution device, I can predict the effect inside it. But that means I need to have quite a lot of insight into what's happening to that device to use that information. So it's quite a challenge in the next step, as I mentioned in the introduction. I'll just finish with the challenge. And this is a little bit hodgepodgey, I must apologise, because it's not didn't have time to assemble it well, i.e. it started at 8:30 this morning. So integrated suite of breakage devices, where might we go? We have a current set, which are some JK ones. We have drop weight tests evolving into RBT, and we use others, like bond tests and things. And really, I feel if we understand how rocks fragment, we can wrap those together into a new suite. And the evolution into the RBT, we have invented here, the constructor of the prototype here. So the real asset to me, despite every marketing thing of how it might be used, is I can run at really low energy. So we can do incremental damage, which we haven't spoken about today. The incremental damage of hitting particles multiple times and then they suddenly break. We're well aware of that, and this machine is good for it. And the drop weight test is not. So this machine is much better for it. So I prefer it from that aspect. But if we go to fine size, and there's Ben with Marcelo on the original show notes breakage device, as it's called, and Grant did many weeks of work on it. It's exceedingly painstaking. Why are we doing that? That's under vacuum because the fine particles you can't project through the air because they just slow down, the drag is too great. So the bottom size of this is about 5 millimeters to be reliable energy. That top size is about 2, just infeasible to run it. That's good. Frank developed the FBC, which is in a bed, it's a loose bed, you get a different number. Single particle. Is there the potential to have a fine single particle test that's not as painstaking as the one on the vacuum? The abrasion one, well, I shouldn't put that just yet. The abrasion one, there's the original mill with the original Simon. Then we've had the evolution to the SWAT test, Everlat on the SWAT device. We didn't talk about the bottom one, which is the using a little cup to try and emulate the abrasion to make it more viable as a lab test. So these are under evolution. We don't have a suitable laboratory test yet. We've explored the area, we understand it, now we need a suitable test. The piston and die, we've got testing devices at the extreme of our big old chunky machines to super sophisticated ones. We have a new method, which I didn't present today, based on volume and porosity reduction. But really we need a slicker testing technique for big breakage instead of a clumsy testing technique. So these are the four main modes. If we can do those, we have a suite that should be able to feed into every breakage device. Thank you.
We filled up all the time. If there's any pressing questions, maybe we can just have one question from the floor to finish up for any of the presenters.
Yes.
Rajiv, yes?
This is to Mohsen. Yes. Interesting work. Just want to ask you, when you're measuring the abrasion rate, you have a flat rock on the disc, which is the breakaway?
Yes.
Have you looked at changing the orientation of that rock, so having a different stress intensity?
Yes, we did with the sharp edges as well. Yeah, you get a different answer.
And you get a different abrasion.
I think it was related to the surface area that was actually...
Yes. Because initially you have a smaller surface area in contact, so the amount of energy per surface area would be very high. Yes.
Yep. And just one last one at the other.
Yeah, it's very interesting. So coming from the geotechnical background, I think geotechnical engineering has been through a similar process to understand that each test is actually not a unit of material, but it's actually a structure. And you can see the same sort of things here where you're seeing that those, you know, you have a different loading shape creates a different stress distribution. And then also the loading rate creates a stress distribution which feeds the information through the structure at a different rate. So you could be, when it's static, the whole sample can see that load, or when it's dynamic, depending on the rate of loading relative to the stress wave. Velocity in that sample, only portions of it are loading, and also the loading rate creates different waves, and those reflective waves create different fracture. So that's maybe why Ben's results are showing similar results for slower and similar for higher speed.
I agree. I think if Ben does a confined test, so you take the sample and confine it, and you get a totally different response.
Yeah.
The other thing I think you and us mentioned in geotechnical development of what we might be assumed, we don't call it the strength. We call it whether it be the compressive strength, or whether it be the shear strength, or whether it be the tensile strength, or whether it be the dynamic, or whether it be the static. That's the reason why I'm saying you need to understand the loading mechanism, how you're applying the stresses, or applying the loading. And then the second thing also we need to understand, how is the breakage mechanism? Those are two things. How are you applying the load, and how the rock is breaking due to those different conditions. Some may be a lot easier to break in compression, some may be a lot easier to break in shear, some may be a lot easier to break in tensile. But that's the kind of thing that we need to really understand. Can we actually match these two things? Because your device applies the loading mechanism, rock behaves how it has to behave, that's it.
So we've initiated a discussion of relating
the
blasting, the mining structure, and the comminution.
That's fantastic.
And that we should be doing tests that give the outputs to all of those.
Yeah. I think there will be a lot of interest can be there if you go back and look at a lot of the fracture mechanics theory.
Yeah, interestingly though, the geotechnical have gone almost to the where the metallurgists were originally, and said that as long as you've got a standard test done in the same way, that represents an index. And the soil mechanics guys have done it for a long time, and that as long as you know what that actually means in the context of whether you're designing a pillar or a slope, you can then use certain factors to do that design. Because it just becomes too complicated to understand the stresses in each of the sample each of the time. So it's a circle that you go through.
Okay. Thank you very much, and come and talk to the presenters afterwards.
Is it, you've turned it off? No.